Good morning, everyone. Welcome from a dark, wet, damp Melbourne. Welcome everyone for being here today. Welcome for our next speaker in the RMIT Cyber series. It's a great honor to have Professor Alicia Bernardini speaking to us, and we'll do the formal introductions in a moment. I would like to start today with an acknowledgement of country. We acknowledge the people of the Wuyang and Boonyang language groups of the Eastern Kulin Nations, on whose unceded lands we conduct the business of RMIT University, and the lands that I'm speaking to you from today. As we gather virtually across many different parts of the country and the world, we would also like you to acknowledge the lands in which you are joining us from. We respectfully acknowledge the First Nations people of the five Kulin Nations, their ancestors and elders, past, present, and emerging. Welcome today. Today we're using the Microsoft Teams Live webinar system. This has a couple of functions to make you aware of. In the top right-hand corner, you'll see a couple of icons. The one with the question mark is where you can post questions, which we'll be answering in the Q&A session at the end. We also have closed captions available. If you select the three dots on your toolbar, it would give closed captions, and translations are also available in different languages. My name's Matt Warren. I'm the director of the RMIT Center for Cybersecurity Research and Innovation here in Australia. In terms of our center, our aim is to carry out quality multidisciplinary research, focusing on the organizational, technology, and human aspects of cybersecurity. This is part of our RMIT Cyber Seminar Series, where we get thought leaders from around the world and from Australia to give insights into different aspects of cybersecurity. Today's very topical, talking about security issues in relation to 5G and 4G networks. I'll hand over to Zaire.
Oh, thank you, Matt. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. And thank you, Eliza, for accepting the invitation. It's really great to have Eliza here with us. And Eliza doesn't really need an introduction, but I have to do it, Eliza, because it's a part of the process. But definitely, everybody knows Eliza in the area of data security and so on. Quickly, about Eliza. Eliza is a professor in computer science at Purdue University, and she's also the director of the Purdue Cybersecurity Center, Security Lab. Before that, like everybody knows, Eliza has been a professor and head of department of computer science and communication lab at Milano University. And she basically, for a lot of years, she set up one of the biggest well-known research lab in cybersecurity. Is well known everywhere, and she trained, and all her previous staff are now well known experts in data security. I don't need to name them, but she can name them, Eliza. And as I said before, Eliza is the world's leading expert in security, in privacy, and database, and her recent research focuses on cybersecurity, privacy of cellular networks and IoT systems. And I would like to note also, Eliza has a lot of decorations. She is the fellow of the ACM, full of the IEEE, and it says it all. Is the world leading expert. She has received a lot of technical achievement awards for 2020 outstanding contribution to databases and database security and advanced database management systems, as well as she received the 2005 IEEE Computer Society Tsutomu Kanai Award for pioneering and innovative research contribution to secure distributed systems. Thank you again, Eliza. It's a great pleasure to have you here. So I will hand in to you now to start the presentation. Thank you. Thank you, Eliza.
Okay. I hope you can see my slide.
Yes.
Okay. So first of all, good morning to everyone. I'm very happy to be at RMIT, even though only virtually. I visited many times. I know many faculty there doing a lot of groundbreaking research in security. So today I'm going to present you some of our work in the area of security of 4G and 5G cellular networks. Cellular networks are today a critical infrastructure supporting many important functions, communications among individuals, but also, for example, they provide an infrastructure for emergency alert, by which those messages can be broadcast to all the cellular phones connected to those networks. In the future, they will have even a more prominent role. Indeed, the new development in the areas of 6G and what is called next generation networks will connect not only humans, but really they will connect a lot of devices, IoT, robots, and so forth. So they will really become even more critical. But of course, because they are a critical infrastructure, any attack or misuse of a cellular network may create major issues. Perhaps you haven't heard this, but several years ago, by mistake, somebody from the Department of Homeland Security sent a message through the emergency alert system notifying that a ballistic missile threat inbound to Hawaii, and there was a distress, and telling the people to seek immediate shelter. And say that this was not a drill, this was a real threat. Of course, this, you know, everyone you can imagine, people got frantic, didn't know what to do. It turned out it was a mistake, but somebody could do this on purpose. So attacks to those networks can disrupt, can provoke panic, can disrupt a lot of important functions. And what I want to say is that many threats of both security and privacy are already very well known since several years. For example, one very important problem was the use of what are called fake base stations, which basically are used as a surveillance technology. Basically, this is like a cell tower with the difference that it has a higher signal strength. And typically, a mobile phone will connect with the cell tower, which has the highest signal strength when there are two, between which the phone has to choose. The reason why the phone will connect to the cell tower with the highest signal strength is because it will save energy. So we require less energy for the phone to communicate with the cell tower. This was found many years ago, it's very well known, you know, everyone knew, newspapers talked about it. Then from the research point of view, many years ago, people shown how somebody can trace the movements by looking at the information from cellular networks. This was a work done probably 7-8 years ago. Then other people shown an attack of denial of service by which users at a certain point were, you know, couldn't get any connectivity. Usually, you know, if you see that your cell phone doesn't work for a while, you start panicking because we are so used to depend on those phones. And keep in mind that this problem can be worse when not really just our phone will depend on cellular networks, but also, for example, IoT devices, robots, autonomous vehicles, and so forth. This may really disrupt a lot of activities. However, this previous work had several shortcomings. So typically, there was a non-systematic approach, and this is a problem which usually affects a lot of research that we do when finding those vulnerabilities. It seems that sometimes those vulnerabilities are found just because of intuition of researchers, and sometimes one finds a vulnerability by chance, but we are far from having more systematic approaches in which we can say, you know, we apply a number of steps, and this would allow us to find better, more vulnerabilities. So this was one previous problem, which is today still a problem. Other approaches had analyzed the control plane protocol interactions in cellular networks, but mainly to analyze the performance and reliability. And in particular, in these frameworks, there was no assumption about the presence of the adversary. But of course, if we want to reason about security, we need to assume that the attacker is in the system and understand what the attacker could do. This is known as the attacker model. Finally, there was other previous work, which again was more related to privacy and looked at very old generation of cellular network. So basically, our goal, our question was whether it was possible to build a systematic framework for analyzing the cellular network protocol specifications to find the security and privacy problems. And this analysis should assume the presence of the adversary doing actions to exploit the vulnerabilities. So in this work I'm going to present, I'll talk mainly about 4G, but we have done later on a similar work for 5G, but it's much more complex to present. That's why we look at 4G. And basically we consider in this presentation three important functions which are attached, by which the phone will connect to the cellular network, the touch and paging. Paging is a very important function. Basically, is the function by which when cellulars are in low power mode, which means that the cellular phone, when it's not being used for communicating, goes in a low power mode to save energy, but periodically will wake up to check whether there are incoming messages. So the cellular base station will broadcast certain messages called the paging messages, and the phone wakes up at certain predefined times to check if there are incoming messages for the phone itself. This is called the paging protocol. Other important functions, of course, are the voice over LTE handover, by which the phone, when the user moves in different location, there is a process to transfer the connection to another cell tower without disrupting the connectivity of the user. Keep in mind that when a phone is connected to a cellular network, at the end of the attach phase, the phone will receive an IP address, which allow the phone then to interact over internet through the cellular network. And when the phone moves, we want to preserve the IP address, for example. So this is done by the handover. Now, we really created the models for all those six functions. But in the paper, and here I'm just going to really, and in the paper we cover only those first three. So let me say, first of all, which were some of the challenges that we found when trying to do define our framework. So first of all, a problem is that those protocols which implemented those functions, for example, the attach functions, are protocols which consist of multiple steps. They are multi-step protocols. They involve multiple participants and they are stateful, which means when executing those protocols, the parties will move into different states. Okay. So they are not the simple protocols. They may have multiple steps. If another practical problem was that we wanted to look at the specification of 4G, and those were written in natural language. So there is no formal model of those specifications. Not only they are written in natural language, this specification, as we will see later on, sometimes have inconsistencies, ambiguity under specification. So that was really a major problem. How could we kind of abstract from those natural language documents and create a model that we could analyze in a systematic way. Finally, of course, a lot of implementations are proprietary. So the implementation of those protocols is proprietary, and there are multiple parties involved in the implementation. The companies involved in manufacturing the baseband processor used from on the mobile phone have their own implementation side. The network provider, of course, have their own implementation in the core network. And those are closed, so it's not that you can see the actual implementation. Finally, at least in the US, there is a legal barrier. We wanted, as we will see, we find attacks, we want to try those attacks, see if they really work, those attacks. Of course, we cannot go and try those attacks on a real networks, because here in the US is illegal. So we couldn't do that. So those were some of the challenges that we had to deal with. So let me give you a little bit, a very quick background on the LTE architecture. So typically in the LTE, in this architecture, which is very high level, we have the tracking area. This area is organized in different cells, and this is the area where the mobile phones move. Each cell has what is called the eNodeB with the terminology of the LTE standard. We can call it a cell tower. Okay. And then at any time the phone is connected to a certain cell tower, and then of course when the user with the phone moves, it gets connected to other eNodeB, and again there are all those protocols for this, for transferring this connection. Then at the center we have what is called the core network. This is the typical terminology. That's the actual network which support all the mobility functions. Okay, so as you can see, this core network internally, those are very complex systems, but it has a lot of important functions as meant for let's say components. The first one is the mobility management entity, MME. This is in charge of tracking the user. In general, those are very efficient, very smart. They always know where the phone may have moved so that they can redirect the calls. There is the HSS, which is the home subscriber services. Those are the part of the core network which keeps all the information about subscribers, including information for authenticating the user and the phone. We have also, of course, the various gateway to connect the phone to the internet and so forth. Now, in what I'm going to say, we really can abstract and refer typically to the core network. And so this is this architecture. and this is the trend. So now I'll give you a very simple example, actually, of a high-level representation of the background of the attach procedure. As I mentioned to you, there are several parties involved. There is a DUE, which is the phone. There is the cell tower and the core network. So in general, this procedure is the first one. When we switch on our phone, that's what the first step that the phone will do before even can do any other activity. So first of all, we'll connect it to the E node B for the physical connection setup. In this phase, the phone will get various physical parameters like the number of frames in the radio channels and so forth. Just this only allows, is useful for the physical connection. The first important step is the attach request. Once the phone is physically connected to the E node B, then the phone will send the attach request, requesting to be attached to the network. And this request will include the international mobile subscriber identifier, called also known as IMCI, which is a number consisting of multiple digits. Two represent the countries, other three are the provider, then there is a unique number inside of the provider. It may also send the identifier of the equipment, IMMI, and then the UE security capabilities. Those capabilities are mainly the algorithms used by the phone for encryption and digital signatures. Keep in mind that the phones have you have legacy phones, they have different capabilities, and cellular networks have to support all of them. That once there is this request, the core network has to authenticate the phone. Okay, make sure that the phone requiring to be attached with a certain IMCI is really the legitimate phone and is the legitimate user. And so the core network will authenticate the user by sending a challenge to this phone. So it's a challenge reply type of authentication using the secret, some secrets which are stored in the SIM card from the phone point of view, and they're stored in the by the home subscriber system, which records the information about the subscribers. So the phone will then reply, and if the reply is correct, then the phone is authenticated. The next step will be the negotiation of the security algorithm, where the core network will select the algorithm to be used among the ones that the phone supports. The phone will confirm those algorithms. And as a last step, the network accepts the attach and allocates a temporary ID called the TMCI. This TMCI has been introduced to avoid the problem associated with sending the IMCI around, which is the first initial identifier sent, as we have seen in the first step. And this was introduced because these identifiers are always present in all the control messages exchanged between the core network and the UE. So everyone being able to eavesdrop the communication could see the IMCI and therefore can infer where the user is moving. With TMCI, this problem should be avoided, provided that the TMCI is changed quite frequently. Somebody did a big data collection about this TMCI and found that some providers don't change it very frequently. So the same TMCI is used for many days. Okay, but that's just is outside of what I'm going to say, just for you to know. So that is this protocol. Now, why it is interesting to look at this multi-step? Because basically the problem here is that the attacker can attack at any point in this multi-step protocol, and there could be multiple vulnerabilities. Okay, so we want basically at the end to understand all the points this when the attacker can attack and what can do during those execution of those protocols. Okay. So the other important point, as I said before, is understanding what is the adversary model or the attacker model. So what can this attacker can do? Which are our assumptions? So in our case, as I mentioned before, we are looking at finding vulnerabilities in the protocols, in the execution of those protocols. And we are very interested in looking, in considering an attack which is sitting, let's say, on the communication between the phone, the UE, and the core network. And therefore, so for example, we are not addressing the case in which you have a malicious application setting on the mobile phone, because our goal was to find vulnerabilities due to mistakes in the definition and design of those protocols proposed by the standardization body. So we were not interested in other attacks. Okay, so that has to be very clear. And for this, we use the very well-known Dolevi-Yao model. Basically, according to this model, an attacker can eavesdrop messages, capture those messages while they're being transmitted, can drop or modify messages, and can inject malicious messages, fabricated messages. So we also assume, this is important, that the attacker complies with cryptographic assumptions. In other words, this means that we assume that if a message is encrypted, for example, the attacker is unable to decrypt the message unless the attacker has the private keys for decrypting the message. So we assume that the attacker does not have those capabilities. So the attacker we assume does not have, for example, the encryption keys used by the two parties, okay? And therefore, this is an important, because otherwise if the attacker could easily decrypt all the messages, and of course there could be many more attacks. And the standards indeed requires that there is encryption, digital signatures, those are important part of the standard. And that's why, you know, we need to know that the adversary that we are considering has this limitation, because the messages are encrypted, and most of them, as we will see, not all of them, or are digitally signed. Okay. So why we consider this? The attacker is quite powerful, and in addition, there are automatic tools that you can use to analyze protocols. Okay, so those tools can tell you if a certain cryptographic protocol has some vulnerabilities and so forth. Now, we had a lot of insight. So which are the properties which are important in try to come up with an approach? So first of all, we have temporal ordering of events. Notice that our protocols are stateful. So we have one event and then the two parties can go in a certain state, other events happen and the parties go to different states. We have cryptographic constructs, and we also have linear integer arithmetic and other predicates when looking at the properties that we want our system to verify. So when we were trying to decide how to proceed, which tools to use to verify those protocols, basically we noticed the model checkers, the conventional model checkers, which are very well known tools for formal analysis, typically of protocols, they support properties which are related to those temporal traces properties, and also linear integer arithmetic. On the other hand, there are other verifiers like the one I mentioned before, which are very good for analyzing cryptographic constructs. So we decided that we want to use both of them to leverage the advantage of both reasoning power of those tools. So that was a main insight. Of course, we worked in our team, we have an expert on formal models, who is expert on all these type of tools that we have available. Now let's look at our methodology, then we'll provide them more details. Our methodology has several steps. First of all, we must provide as input to our methodology an abstraction of the protocol. So those abstractions are in terms of finite state machines or transition diagram, if you wish. You must have one for the representing the phone and the other one representing the core networks. Remember, we are looking at analyzing the interactions between those two. But of course, we need to add the adversary in this model because we want to analyze the behavior of the system when the attacker tries to do the actions that we have seen before. And so basically we add this adversary. And so we have at this point that our model is instrumented with this specific adversary. Once we have this instrumented model, then we use an off-the-shelf model checker. This is, as I said before, is a very well-known category of methodology and proposed many, many years ago. And typically, once you have to provide the model and also properties that you want to verify, typically the model checker will take the model and the property. And then we'll basically, if the property is verified, they will tell you that the property is verified. If the property is violated, which means does not hold, then we return you a scenario listing all the steps in the execution of the model which leads to this violation. Okay. And basically for us, such a violation is a potential attack because basically the adversary is trying to prevent the system to reach the states that we want the system to reach. So in other words, if my phone is trying to do an attack, I want the phone eventually to attach to the core network, okay? The attacker may try to disrupt the successful completion of this protocol. For example, may try to prevent my phone to reach the state of being connected successfully, and therefore resulting in a denial of service attack because my phone won't be able to connect to the network. Okay, and that's the scenario we are interested. However, it provides a counter example again, which is a scenario in which shows that the property is violated. But then remember, because we also have a certain cryptographic assumption, we needed to do an additional step, run the counter example through the crypto protocol verify to check whether this scenario of attack is possible under the cryptographic assumption. Finally, we really take, once we see that this attack is possible under the cryptographic assumption, which means the attacker can do the attack even though cannot decrypt, for example, encrypted messages, then we still try the attack on a test bed. Because in some cases, cellular phones may have built some protection. So we try the attack on our own test bed to see whether the attack is really possible. And that is our entire methodology. So let me give now more details. So first of all, as I said before, we need to have a model of those protocols in terms of finite state machine. So this took us a lot of time, mainly to the student who was the main researchers in this work. This was his PhD thesis. And he had to spend months and months to analyze this written documentation and to provide a certain abstraction. So here, as you can see, we have an example of two finite state machines. As you can see, those finite state machines have different states and they have transitions. It is important to notice that those transitions are annotated with a certain expression. And those expressions consist of a precondition written in italics and followed by an action, or an action, and of course, so this will basically say that, for example, let's look at transition one, that this is a transition by which the phone will move to the next step, which is waiting for the authentication request. And this happens if the phone has been restarted, and not only the phone will transition to the next state, but will send the attached request. In some cases, when for transition, we don't have any action to be executed. For example, when the phone is in the waiting for authentication request, it can happen that the authentication request, the authentication is rejected, or the phone gets a detached request. In this case, the phone will simply transition back to the disconnected state without executing any action. Now, what I want to emphasize is that this model only covers what is the non-access stratum layer, which is the highest layer in the protocol stack. Later on, we also analyzed the layer before, which is the radio communication control, which is the layer before. So we only focus on what is really more what is more software oriented. Basically, those protocols are implemented all in software, but this is the highest level. Our condition uses a very simple propositional logic, like authentication reject is a predicate, again, true or false. So we have a very simple logic. We model only message types and not the message data. So as we can see, this is quite an abstraction. And finally, we abstract away cryptographic construct. As you can see here, for example, we have a predicate which says MAC failure, which is true, indicate that we have a failure in the verification of a digital signature. We don't care, you know, the actual algorithm used to verify those signatures. Because of course, this depends on the digital signature techniques. At our level, we just need to see whether this has been, you know, the signature is not valid. In this case, as you can see, if the signature is not valid, or the phone and the core network have desynchronized, then the result will be an authentication failure action, and the phone will go back to the previous state. So we do a number of simplification. I have to say much more about, because as you can see, we do a certain abstractions. Of course, if you abstract a lot, you lose a lot of details, so you may miss some potential vulnerabilities. But on the other hand, if the protocol is too detailed, you may end up with huge state transition diagrams, which in some cases, the model checkers are unable to scale. We have some real recent experience on that specific aspect. So the model checker, as I said before, has a certain support, certain properties like liveness, something good eventually happens. So once the phone is waiting for authentication, eventually will authenticate. So that's what we want our system to do, to happen. Nothing bad happen. So this is a typical example of a property that we provide to the model checker. This property says whenever the UE is in the wait for authentication request, eventually will authenticate. We'll end up in the final state in which the phone authenticates also the network, because I forgot to say this before, but the authentication is mutual. And that's the state where we want to reach. Any sequence of actions which prevents the phone from getting to this state can be the result of a potential attack. We want to find which are the vulnerabilities which would prevent this happy ending of the execution of the protocol. Okay. Let me say something about the testbed validation. So, as I said before, we couldn't try the attacks on the real cellular network. So, my students built our own testbed. And this testbed, basically, as you can see, had several had a setup consisting of a malicious cell tower. Okay, emulating a rogue cell tower. We also had a malicious UE. Okay, and then we bought several phones from off of the shelf from several companies, SIM cards of four major US carriers. So we got from the major provider here, and we built a core network. And then we use the software which is publicly available, for example, the software for the cell tower, OpenLT, and so forth. So we could build this small testbed to try the attacks. Now, let me show you our findings. Using our methodology, we uncovered the 10 new attacks which were unknown before, and as you can see, we also wanted to check which is the responsible for these vulnerabilities. And as you can see, in most cases, those were due to problem in the standard. Standard, again, is very complex. It's very difficult to write those standards. So in most cases, attacks were due to problem with the, you know, problems with the standard. And for each attack, we also show the impacts that this can have. So as you can see, we range from denial of service attack to location training and denial of service and so forth. We also shown that with our methodology, we could uncover 9 prior attacks, which people had identified, by using not a systematic approach. Okay, so I want to show you a very simple example of such an attack, which is the authentication or synchronization of failure attack. This is an attack which attacks the following mechanism. In order to provide the reply protection, both the UE and the core network maintain a counter of messages which have been exchanged between the two parties. Okay. And there is an important constraint that the difference between those two counters must be below a certain number. If the difference is greater, the result will be the phone will be disconnected from the network, because a large difference may indicate replay attacks. So we can see how the attacker can exploit this problem to make the phone being disconnected from the network. Which are the assumptions? The attacker must know the UEIMCI. So it must have a malicious phone impersonating the victim. So this phone will have to pretend to be the IMCI. So we'll use the IMCI when sending the initial attachment to the cell tower and then to the core network. So what the attacker will do, will send attach request to the core network. Remember, the attach request is the initial steps. There is no encrypted channel established. This happens after the negotiation of the security algorithm. So as sending this IMCI, the core network will increment this counter, will add one. And what happened, we noticed that the malicious UE can send multiple attach requests and the core network just keeps incrementing the counter on its side. Okay. Then now, when the victim wants to connect or want to send a message, at this point, the UE and the counter on the core network will be increased quite a lot. So there will be a huge difference between the counter and the victim and the counter at the core network. As a result, the sequence number are desynchronized and the phone is disconnected from the network. So if you go back and were to look at our diagram of defined state machines, you can see that when those counters have a major difference. The phone, in whatever state it is send back, is a disconnected. It's better to go back to the disconnected state. Or we'll have to try again to reconnect, okay? Now, in addition to this, we have done a lot of other work. We have, of course, analyzed the actual implementation of those protocols. Again, there the problem now that you deal, now you look at big code, because typically this code is quite large. How do you extract the finite state machines out of them? We were able to do such an extraction by leveraging the testing infrastructure. We worked with a company, and my student did an internship and was able to come up with a very smart idea to extract these finite state machines from the actual code. As a result, this other finite state machine is much more detailed because now was extracted from an actual implementation. It was larger than the one we had obtained from the natural language document of the standardization documents. And so with the fine grained, we were able to find more vulnerabilities. We have also extended, many of those vulnerabilities are still somehow in 5G, some have been fixed. We have done a similar analysis for 5G. This is much a more complex model because we now model two layers, the NAS and the resource control the RCC layer below. So now we have four different state machines. Attackers can be in both layers, so we may have two different attackers. And so it's a much more complex model. Then we also looked at some defenses. One interesting case which I want to report is that we noticed that one problem that we, this was a big surprise, but it's very well known, that the cell towers have to continuously broadcast certain special messages. Those are the master information block, MIB, the system information block. Those contains all the physical parameters allowing the cell phones to physically connect to the base station. And those messages are not digitally signed. So this was a surprise because everyone knows that you have to digitally sign messages. They were not. Keep in mind that they are broadcast very frequently, like the MIB every 40 milliseconds. And those are not encrypted because basically any phone getting nearby a cell tower has to be able to read the content of those messages. In this case, encryption is not critical, but digital signatures are. Because otherwise, you have no guarantees that you are being connected to a legitimate base station. You can be connected to a rogue base station. So we looked a little bit into this problem. Now, the G3PP at that time suggested to use a symmetric key authentication based on Tesla and asymmetric key authentication. We looked at asymmetric because we looked at this Tesla algorithm, but we found some issues with it. So we said, let's try using a conventional, you know, public key encryption with certificate, because we thought that this is a very, you know, a very well-known type of techniques. It should be very easy to use them. But we got a bunch of surprises. We understood that it's not so easy. And let me elaborate why. So first of all, we had a lot of requirements. Basically, you need to minimize the signature size. This is critical to save bandwidth, and this is very critical for the operators of network. For them, the spectrum is a very important resource, and they want to make money out of it. If you say you have to add a digital signature of, you know, 500 bytes, they will say this is too expensive, it's enough, you know, it will waste bandwidth. Unfortunately, security has a cost. On the other side, we needed to minimize the signature generation time because notice those MIB and SIB messages are broadcast very frequently. So if you take a while to generate those signatures, this is going to be a problem. Finally, You need also to minimize the signature verification time. Now, this is critical to reduce the energy cost at the UE. Here we talked again with a company manufacturing those broadband processors, and that's the first thing they told us. Or the signature, if it is expensive to verify, it will spend a lot of energy. They're really keen on saving energy, okay? So that was the other problem. So we had to do, I would say, a lot of engineering. So we had to, first of all, we decided at that time we couldn't find a signature schemes which would minimize all the three. So we then decided to optimize to address the first two requirements. We didn't care about the signature verification time because this is only done when the phone initially attached to the cell tower. After that, you know, it doesn't need to use this MIB or SIB. And so we had to do a lot of fine tuning and optimization, including design a very lightweight certificate. We had to remove a lot of content from those certificates, then decide which of the two messages were really critical to be signed. So we noticed that the SIB was the most important, and therefore we only authenticated the digital sign of the SIB and only specific types of this SIB. And in addition, we do signature aggregation, which means instead of sending, if you send two messages, you will send one signature for each message. Instead, we aggregated the signature and send only one aggregated signature in order to even save bandwidth. Finally, we used some cryptographic scheme level optimization, which used the pre-computation and so forth. This had been developed by a researcher who is expert on this. So, and basically I have done, so this is what we have done, and basically we made available on this website this model that we generated by analyzing the documentation. So at this point I'll stop sharing and
thank you very much for the great talk, Elisa. It was really great. I have a lot of questions. What I will do, I will quickly summarize them to you. I will start from the general ones to the specific ones, right?
Yeah.
The general ones, there are two, with 5G and the 6G being critical, part of the critical infrastructure. What is the role of the government to protect these networks?
Okay. That's a very important question, okay. So basically, this is a complex ecosystems, and the government, in a way, it's not that may have a certain rule or certain, for sure it has to, for example, regulate issues related, for example, to attacks. And so we were wondering, for example, about the fake base stations. We were talking with somebody from a company and said, but suppose we have a way to find those fake base stations. But they told me, yeah, even if we find them, what do we do? Because unless you have a policies and regulation forbidding their use, right, there is nothing you can do.
No, it's even a policy.
Exactly, those are policies.
That's right, absolutely. The other one, quickly, a general one, but it's really important because what happened in RMIT, we had a serious attack in a few months ago.
Yeah.
It stopped all our networks.
Yeah.
And the question is, what type of advice about working at university context? The question is as follows: how to speak to university leadership, IT services, and recent compliance offices about the need to support this type of work?
Yeah.
This means how to protect, probably protect the networks and so on.
Yeah, but keep in mind that in general, the attacks that we have shown are very, they're not sophisticated, but somehow when we look at what are the problems, why we have those attacks, those vulnerabilities, actually it came down, to be honest, to the lack, in some cases, of adoption of very well-known security practices. So most of those 10 vulnerabilities were due basically to lack of digital signatures, like in the case of the base station. Okay. So those messages are not digitally signed. In some cases, certain messages are digitally signed, but the phone would not verify the digital signatures. Because the phone was assuming once it had an encrypted connection with the core network, everything would be secure. And therefore wouldn't need to verify those things. Instead, we found an attack where this was possible, okay? And the other, so what happened? So that's the real problem, that sometimes you have attacks because there is the lack of a good security practices adoption. And this happens not only for cellular networks, happens all the major data breaches are just because people have, you know, vulnerabilities like injection vulnerabilities,
I will go to the more specific questions now, and there are several of them. I will just to pick a few of them because I think we have to wrap up. The question is, one of them is, why do you use Doyle VAU model instead you don't use Stride model?
Can you repeat me the name of
why Doyle VAU model is used instead of Stride?
We didn't look at the other model, and so I wouldn't know actually a reply on top of my head. Just we went directly to look at Doyle VAU because it was widely used for that we have seen for those type of analysis. That is a good comment. We were thinking about looking at other models in the future. But again, for us, basically, as I said before, we are looking at attacks which really deals with the communication channel.
Right. The other ones, there are several of them. What's about the brute force attack? What's about the adversary attacks from the core networks? What's about these type of attacks?
Okay, that's a very good question. Now, remember, we don't cover attacks which happen because the core network is compromised. Okay. And what I want to add, that if we were to protect a network, what I have shown is only a very small part into this protection, because we only look at those protocols for those procedures. Mm. Now, the network itself is on code. If it is on a cloud, and most of it will be, as it to be protected against tampering, against insider threat. So basically, you can think as a core network, very large complex systems with all the problems that you, all the security problems may affect the core network. Okay, it's not that our analysis is only the protocols. But then if you have, for example, a software implementing the home subscriber system, if it uses SQL and you have SQL injection vulnerabilities in the code implementing those services, you know, exactly. It would be a monumental problem in a way. Now, some network providers are talking about using zero trust architectures to enhance security. But,
that's quite well adopted, the zero trust with identity-based access control, right? And it's quite well adopted in the. I wanted to ask you this question, but you raised it. It's quite well adopted by certain major organizations, but not by all organizations, right? The zero trust architecture.
To be honest, zero trust architecture in the US has been pushed a lot because of the president. There was an executive order by the White House mentioning zero trust architecture. Okay. But the idea would be that basically you assume that your network, your system may have adversaries inside. You have to check continuously, but may be implemented in many different ways. And there are a lot of issues. The problem would be that you will need to come up with a lot of security, like access control, identity policies.
That's correct.
And you need that they have to be correct, because another important thing about security is a lot of attacks are due also not because you have a vulnerabilities, but because of misconfigurations in your security tools, security appliances. After all, if you have a firewall, you put the wrong rules. But when you will need to come up with hundreds of rules, it's very easy for a human to do mistakes. So that's another problem that you will
have. The other side. It's not just the technical part, but the human side. The human side is really critical. Yeah. Right? There's a last question to wrap up. And say, considering cyber attacks on mobile network infrastructure and on application running on the phone, what are the percentage of the attacks on the network infrastructure and application? And the second question, what is the payoff of cyber criminals to attack mobile network infrastructure?
Okay, let me say the following. So far, I don't think I have seen a lot of attacks because currently attacks are mainly done for money, for getting money. Okay, that's why you have all those ransomware attacks, because there actually you have a very rich ecosystem with those ransomware. There is a dark net where you can buy tools, buy services, people sell exploits. Okay, so this is done for money. Okay, however. So they try to hack inside of the data, but more and more there are ransomware attacks on pipeline. For example, there was the energy pipeline in the US. This was a critical attack, which disrupted the supply of oil. And this was done, and they had to pay probably. So somebody can use a network vulnerability to disrupt this type of infrastructure, mm-hmm. and you have to pay. Or worst can be done by enemy states who want to sabotage. Mm-hmm. Okay, I haven't seen, fortunately, so far, but that is going to be a problem. Keep in mind that in particular, one problem that if a country tries to be very hard against this ransomware organization, they may counteract, even paralyze a network. So you have to be very careful. That's it, because they are very powerful.
It's the balance.
Exactly.
I think we have to wrap up, Eliza. It's really great to have you, Eliza. I really enjoyed it, and a lot of people enjoyed it as well. And hope we'll keep in touch. We'll hope to
see you
at the research center in Melbourne when everything is open. Thank you again. Maybe Matt, do you want to say something, Matt? The director of research, Matt, is he around? No. So I would like to wrap up. Thank you again. Thank you for everybody.
Thank you. Enjoy the rest of the day.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Have a nice day. Thank you, everybody. And thank you for the question. Thank you. And see you next time. Bye-bye.